Hello, everyone. So now we're going to have James Cunningham, which is a filmmaker and a senior lecturer at the Media Design School in New Zealand.
Hello, good afternoon. So I'm from Media Design School. Today I'll give an attempt to give you an in-depth look at the pipeline and processes that go into making visual effects. But first, it might be good to clarify exactly what are visual effects. So visual effects are described as the process by which imagery is created and manipulated outside the context of a live action shot. Right, so the stuff that live action shot is the stuff that you film through a real camera, and so stuff that's not computer generated or drawn. Right, VFX is the stuff that you add to a real shot, or the stuff that you might take a piece out of that shot and mess with it. Most of the time, we never see visual effects. I mean, we all think of big things exploding and animals and creatures, but there's actually the bulk of visual effects that are in films and TV is the stuff that you never see. It's usually things that people are fixing up. You might have heard of this phrase, fix it in post. Is that familiar? I don't know if you... It's the running gag on any film set is, oh, never mind, we'll fix it in post. They'll do it later. Basically, because as digital post-production has evolved and gotten more and more powerful, it's cheaper to often fix it in post. So we'll actually show you a couple of examples where they probably should have fixed it in post as an example of how, where visual effects should have been used. You might recognize this. This is the Gladiator movie. There's a great moment in here where right there you can see, and we'll just slow it down, take it back. There's a gas canister in the back of the thing, and they didn't have them in ancient Rome, right? And this one from Star Wars, it's a bit of a blooper where they really should have had some VFX to fix this, where the guy would run it back, boom. Right, so VFX would have been great, or they could have just done another take. Right, so VFX is not magic, despite what my mum says. Right, creating visual effects takes many different people doing many different roles. It's often a mix of very technical people and very artistic. The technical programmers are key to staying at the bleeding edge of what is possible, and the other highly creative artists, they make it look pretty, right? They make things move, light things beautifully, and make things move beautifully. Ideally, you have the best artists are the one that marry, are the ones that marry the best of those two things. They're highly technical and highly visually capable. So just what exactly is CGI? I don't know. People bandied around, but so computer-generated imagery. It can get used synonymously with computer animation, but basically, so visual effects is usually CGI combined with live action to look photographically real. CGI elements into a live action plate or background, right? But don't they both suck? Right, didn't VFX ruin films? Weren't films better before visual effects? There's many examples of really, really bad visual effects. The Ang Lee Hulk, the terrible Bond film where he surfs down a wave. The Scorpion King, anyone see that one? No? That's just still got scars from that where they put that back in. And then this is the most scarring of all, of course, was Jar Jar. Right, so... the problem with these films is that they were all attempts to do something before the technology was ready. That's been their mistake. So actually, yeah. So this is a clip from. Oops, I'll go back. This is a clip from the new Jungle Book, the film that will probably win the Oscar for best VFX this year. Let's see if this is going to play. Let's see. For the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and strife. Alright, so this is what they actually filmed. Right, so the boy is real. Most of the time. Not all of the time. Right, in the wide shots, it'll be what we call a digi-double. So a fully digital boy. The closer shots, the boy is real and they've got a furry belly. for him to be on, and there's the water that interacting right around his feet. But at some point, they're blending that water right there with the water, with CGI water, right? Because the CGI, the real water, has got directors in it and blue screens and a whole lot of crap they've got to get rid of, right? So they're basically going to have CGI water. And in fact, many of the times, they basically chop the boy off at the hips. Basically, his pants, they use that line around the pants to chop him off, and basically did CGI legs. So basically, he's real most of the time, probably from about here up. Everything else is visual effects. There's another great use of visual effects here, where motion capture is able to create phenomenal dramatic performances. This is some of the, where I feel like the, some of the best visual effects work going on. And again, it's not, there's so much sort of fear about visual effects and animation taking away jobs of actors, but this is all driven by actors, mostly. Right, so visual effects is a tool, right? And it's here to stay. Some people are against it. There is a definite bias or snobbery against VFX. It's done by a computer. Don't you just press buttons, right? It's done on a computer. But yeah, I would not be surprised if many of those people don't realize half of what they're seeing as visual effects because they're ignorant of how it's done. But yeah, anything now is possible. It's not necessarily easy, but given the time and the resources, pretty much anything can be done. Yeah, there's no excuses for bad VFX. There's no reason to do a bad job anymore. So I'll just show you some clips of some of my work. This is shots and things I've done for other people. So some of the film work I've done, some of the shots from Lord of the Rings, that little thing there. lighting. And an arrow, and there's some set extensions. See, it was a little green screen Gandalf. Lighting cave trolls. This is a low budget film, and we made in New Zealand. Lots of fun doing stupid, dumb stuff, blowing up cars and flying them across the Cook Strait. Some of the TV commercial work. Did a whole lot of TV commercials for American trash bags, Glag trash bags. This is an ad I'm really proud of. This is for an Australian beer company where the heads are all CGI, so basically you're chopping off the real actors' heads, animating them to match, and the prosthetic heads are actually all the background characters. So yeah, the CGI heads gave us far more control. We did a form of sort of object tracking to be able to get their performances in place. Cool. And this is some of my work as a director, some of the stuff that, yeah, where I'm in the driver's seat. This first one, this is pretty old, this is about 1999, a short film I made a long time ago, yeah. Sitting in the spare room for most of a year. This is some of the work that I've made with my students at Media Design School. Thank you. this I'm going to show you, this is one of my recent films, it's about 5 minutes, you watch the whole one.
Come on kids, it's nearly morning. Time for bed.
Story time! Yay!
Snuggle in, nice and warm. Now remember, it's a scary world out there. And the most dangerous thing of all is...
humans!
That's right. Andrew the Adder was altered by Otto. Brenda the Bumblebee, bowled by a barrow. Colin the Cricket was covered in chunder. Dana the Dragonfly drowned here down under. Edgar the Earwig was echoed apart. Freddy the Firefly fried by a fart. Jeffrey the Gerbil engendered a goal. Hannah the Hedgehog hid down the wrong hole. Ivan the Inchworm was idly impaled. James the Jerboa was unjustly jailed. Kelly the Killer Bee was kicked by the Keeper. Lisa the Lemming was leveled by Leaper. Mary the Mantis made a god-awful mess. Neville the Newt was not news at Loch Ness. Ollie the Octopus went out for the ocean. Peter the Possum was pickled in potion. Quentin the Quail was quashed by a quince. Robert the Rooster rubbed out by the rinse. Stephen the Stink Bug was sliced by a sneeze. Ted the Tarantula couldn't tolerate trees. Ulrich the Arachabird, he was undertaken. Vanita the Vinegarfly was caught ventilated. Wirimu the Wetter, he went the wrong way. Xander the Xenopus, he expired by X-ray. Yasmin the Yellow Jacket was hit by a yachting cap. Zachary the Zebrafly got done by a zephyr zap. How was that?
It's my favorite. My favorite.
Sleep tight, you little rascals.
Don't let the big bugs bite.
Yeah, so it's a bit grim, but yeah. Sorry about that. If you're upset by little things dying, it's all right. They're not real. It's okay. How many VFX artists does it take to make a film? Do you ever stay and watch the credits at the cinema? Right. I took the credits from the recent Hobbit film and just got the VFX section. And I've sped this up 3 times. Right. There's hundreds and hundreds of people. my killers is good. The Hobbit films employed about 500 to 600 people. Far more of them actually worked on the filming. What the hell do they all do, right? Little red dots that are flashing up, there's some of my students. So I'll try and break this down in terms of what they're doing and what the different jobs are, because there's, as you can see, there's heaps of different areas that people are doing and working in visual effects, but what on earth are they? All right, some terminology before we kick in. These are kind of the before, the film, making a film can be broken into these three stages: pre-production, production, and post-production. All right, so pre-production is the planning, production is the filming, actors on set, costumes and all that, and post was traditionally just editing and sound with a bit of grading, right? And so now visual effects comes into that last finishing area. So let's take a brief look at the pre-production process. So previs, this is the area where you basically, hang on, what have we got going on? This is,
idea that we were
hang on, this is, oh, yeah, her key part, sorry. Key part with the recent technology from some of the post-production has come across into helping out planning at the start of a film. You basically, before you go in and shoot, especially any shots with visual effects, you're going to basically try and work out where you're going to be putting the camera, where someone, you might have seen those shots where someone's like yelling at a tennis ball on a stick. They've got to try and work out how big the creature is. They're going to go in and work and basically plan that all out. Now that previs can be as simple as having a little toy airplane you're flying around and with a camera and working out your shots as a director, working out your shots. But it can get far more complicated to where you're actually doing a rough animation of everything. So someone like Peter Jackson.
Idea that we were playing with at the beginning was that he speaks to Bilbo, but it's a telepathic conversation, so Smaug's not moving his lips.
You hear me? Few in Middle-earth possess that power.
When we did the previous pass where Smaug spoke psychically to Bilbo, it just didn't work. There was just something about it that just didn't work.
Yeah, so someone like Peter Jackson, he'll throw entire teams at a sequence or a film to try and work out. It's almost like part of his writing process. He has that much money to do all that sort of stuff, yeah. So this area is growing a huge amount. The most complex version of this is now called virtual production, where the best example is, I mean, I don't have time to go into detail, but like The Jungle Book is the best example of that at the moment, where you've got a boy and maybe a rock that's real. Everything else is CGI. And it's going to be, I think it might even be, it's almost an animated film, entirely an animated film. And so, but in order for them to work out where the light, where the sun is, what the shadows of the leaves are on him, in order to film that, they need to go and actually make the film before they make the film. That's this virtual production process, but yeah, we won't go into that. So we'll have a look at the quick process of filming VFX. So this is, this is our VFX camera rig and system. We shoot on a Sony FS7. The big thing on the back is just a battery, but jammed in between there is a special ProRes adapter that allows us to shoot 4K in log color space. We use a slider, which allows us to get a lot of parallax in some of our shots, which will help with the tracking, which I'll go into in a minute. There's a little black cable you can see coming out of the back of the camera. Well, that's an SDI cable, and that feeds the raw video into this little box called an Odyssey recorder. So besides being a full HD review screen, it actually has two SSD, half gig SSDs rated together so that we can record 4K raw onto this. More often than not, though, we are recording ProRes. It's great. It also allows, in the times when you actually have to get out there and do some acting yourself, you can actually watch what's going on. But the main use of it is for reviewing shots. Right? You want to make sure that it was in focus. You got the thing you needed to tell the story. The camera's not shaking or anything like that. Yeah. We also have this, so she's holding a clapper, but on the back of our clapper we have this little strip of grey. It's a special grey, 18% grey card, which means when we point our camera at it, we can, using the waveform monitor, we can get an exact exposure reference. We don't have to go out there with light meters these days. So the kit is quite light and quite small and amazingly affordable. This sort of kit would have cost, like 4 or 5 years ago, would have been 10 times as much in terms of what it cost to buy this gear. So now we've had a look at the filming side, we'll have a look into the post-production where the VFX is more concentrated. So this is a rough schematic. Okay, you guys can't read it that well. Okay, there's the steps in detail of what tasks are doing on a single VFX shot. So we start with, these are our shots, individual shots, one shot A, B, C, and so on. We take that through into the edit. There we're maybe cutting in an Avid or Premiere Pro, and we will convert the S-Log into a linear color space EXR. That's our standardized format. But before you can, before we do a VFX shot, you need to get a CG asset. Right, so that's this little piece of the puzzle. So here are the key pipeline steps in building an asset, starting off with your art, model, rigging, and surfacing. Art's where you're designing, model is building the 3D model. It'll keep going again. It can break down in a little more detail, right? So the rig can be separated out into rigging of a body, rigging of a face, and rigging of facial blends. And sometimes an asset may have fur, hair, or other VFX aspects to it. But say on a simple asset, might just have these three steps. Let's have a look at that. Have a look at this guy. So the gun, creating this guy, we had one artist in this case, was really, really talented artist, was able to basically do the entire design, model, and surfacing on this. My notes have disappeared. Oh, here we go. So we're starting off a lot of reference. We start then using this, designing this process of working out the silhouettes, looking at the surfaces, looking at the process of what materials it might be made from, and those materials might inform the design of the form. Is then creating this 3D mesh. And we can see that on the far, I should have made this a bigger. We found an amazing reference on set when we were doing our recce, which formed us more of this, because we needed this thing to be dangerous. It needed to be something dangerous, but it would then turn out to be something boring. We found this really cool thing on set for strapping that worked really well as a new point. So we're doing more design work, more refining the model, and by this stage, you can see on the last image, we've actually had the film shoot, and we've actually got some plates where we can start lining up the model and seeing how it works in context. We then realized that it wasn't reading as being dangerous enough, so we went back, looked at more reference of guns, looking at the angle of how a handle of a gun, and then went back and refined it until we got our final model. Now we go into the surfacing stage. First step is creating what's called UVs, so that's the texture space, a way to align a 2D map onto a 3D model. We're testing out the gray shaders and testing out some reflections, getting more textures on there, and there's our final one. So the final asset had to be realistic and believable, yet kind of quite unique. Now imagine doing that for every prop and every character in a film. You can kind of see how the hours and hours and hours are built up. But on a bigger production, each of those steps would often be divided into separate people. Be one person doing the art, and that drawing would then get handed to the modeling person. And they'd do some models, and it might not work, and then it would go back to that person. Then it would to the designer. Then it might then go forward to the texturing person, and it might go back to the models person. So there's a bigger production can become unwieldy and sometimes quite inefficient. So we'll delve a little bit into rigging. Rigging is creating a control system for an asset of a character. And this is really quite a design challenge because you're trying to work out the most efficient way to control the surface. Think of it as like creating a puppet, like a skeleton inside a puppet. So here's probably one of the most complex rigs one of the students has done is for this octopus, right? Because an octopus doesn't have any bones. It's just muscle tissue. It's phenomenally difficult. And you've got such a detailed surface, you need somewhere to control it. Yeah, this is a nice breakdown. So here's the Python script that the rigger and modeler created to automatically generate all his bone system. He's also created some procedural noise for wind noise. Yeah. A lot of the repetitive tasks can be automated through Python scripting. And for facial, here's an example of a facial rig. So here the rigger is really creating these control systems in order to make it easy for an animator to use. Right, the animator just has to pick that curve and move that curve, and then the rest of the piece of the face that's relevant will move. So now we've seen a little peek under the hood of asset creation. So the art here, you can read on that screen, I suppose. Yeah, so art here feeds into the model. Model goes into the rig, into the surface, and kind of go around in a circle until they're ready to fire out into the rest of the pipeline. So now we're ready to have a look at the shots, how we actually go into making a shot. And the first thing here is tracking. So tracking is where you are match moving either the camera or an object in the scene. You need to, if you've filmed something, if I get a film camera and film this, and I want to put something CGI into this, I need to create a digital camera that's moving exactly the same as the real world camera in the 3D space. So if we watch an example of really, really bad tracking, you can kind of see what not to do. So here the CG camera is out of sync with the virtual, with the real camera. This is an example of where we're tracking has gone well. So what we do is we give the software this sequence of frames. The little black dots on the ground, that's something I've rendered in to check my track. But the software will analyze the frames and look for patterns and textures that it can actually follow through. You feed it what the film back, the size of the sensor, tell it what lens you're using, and it basically works out what possible camera could have seen that movement. Now, some of the things that are also going on here, there are areas that we can't track, right? Things that are moving, like her socks. And there's also in the defocus background out here, there was a whole lot of noise. We couldn't track any of that. Well, if you look closely also at the floorboards when she walks, the floorboards move. So again, we can't, so those in another area of the shot that we had to basically ignore. But the critical area is where the contact is going to be with the CGI. And here's our final shot. So sometimes you will, not every shot in a film is a moving camera. Sometimes there are what we call it a lock-off. This camera's on a tripod and it's not moving. It's a static shot. But if you're going to add CGI, you still need to have a camera match for that, for a lock-off shot. What you can do on set, a little tip, is you at the end of your filming of your shot, just tip the camera over on its tripod and feed this to the software. It will very quickly track something like this, no problem at all. And then you just take the first frame, and that gives you your camera position, and kind of a point cloud of all the objects and stuff in your scene. The next step that is sort of with people who have very, very deep pockets is to get a LiDAR scanner. But they cost about 50,000 euros or something like that for a LiDAR scanner, so I can't afford one of those yet. But that's where you get a laser scan of your entire scene. So object tracking, sometimes you're not tracking the entire camera, but just something in the scene. Here's an example where, so you can see the markers on her collar. We couldn't afford to do the glass bubble around her. Also, it would ruin the sound and she might suffocate. So we basically thought we'd do it CGI, right? So object tracking is a lot of manual process of tracking those little markers. And then we were able to put the metal ring and do a CGI glass bubble around her. Yep. sometimes you also need to do both. You actually need to do a camera track and an object track. So here's an example where we put all these bits of junk around on the ground that are going to be out of the shot. They're not going to be in the, they can be matted out. But it gives the camera something to track. So we track the camera movement down, the tilt down and tilt up. We get all that. And then once we've got that solved, we go in and then track the collar. So after tracking, that can move into layout. So layout is the sort of preparation step where you're basically feeding in all your assets and your camera, your tracked camera, and getting it all ready to be passed on to animation. And this is the step where it all starts to come to life. So you've probably seen something like this before. I'll just use an example of a 2D animation. And the principles are the same, right? So here are all the frames that go into creating this animation. An animator is focused in really in creating, the keyframes, right? So, but by default, the software won't create those nice arcing movements. You've got to then go in and work on the splining to make it work as you'd expect here. So an animator, the computer does help by doing the in-betweening, doing those interpolations, but you still need to be able to understand what a good ball bounce looks like. You still need to be able to see and understand and translate that and use it as a tool. It doesn't do it all for you. So we'll go through a breakdown of creating the animation on a shot like this. It was quite a complex shot. So first up, the animators do a lot of reference. They spend about 2 weeks, I think, just downloading the internet in terms of kitten videos and looking at photos of cats. But all that reference was really valuable in terms of training them in terms of understanding how a cat moves. How does a kitten move versus an older cat? So here, one of the first steps, we've had our filming and we're still in the process of editing. And I'm pretty sure I want to use this take, but I just want to make sure. So the animator then drew over the plate and basically very quickly roughed out the animation. So then that feeds back into the edit. We call this post-viz. And it's much faster just to draw it, because otherwise to do a 3D model doing this, I don't think it was ready at that point. Hadn't tracked the camera yet, so just it's faster to draw it. So once we do have a model and rig ready, and we have a camera track, we can start doing the first stage, which is blocking. So you can see that the cat's movement is all steppy. It's all just going from pose to pose. You'll see up here the reference that the animator is using. She's found a really good reference of moments of the cat doing movement or a kitten climbing some stairs. And this is fantastic in terms of a communication tool between the animator and the director in terms of where she's going. And then a couple of days later, she's doing another pass at the blocking, refining a few things. We had some ideas of where the contact needed to go, and then more blocking. And now she's adding more of the refining that blocking stage, adding more in-betweens, manually doing a lot of that stuff. And now she's moving to splining. So now she's got the timings all set. We can go in and actually refine the curves. The process of doing animation, you'll see, is actually like iterative. You're going through and refining. You don't start from the beginning and just animate it perfectly all the way through. That's kind of like, it's one of the things that terrifies me about doing stop motion, is because that's how they have to do things, right? They have to animate it once all the way through. And if it breaks somewhere, they've got to start all over. Here, if you want to adjust the timing, you want to make sure you get it, knock it out, and get the timing right in these early blocking stages. Here we're doing we've thrown it now into the renderer to kind of, this gives us an idea of what the contacts are looking like. Especially with visual effects, you'd want to make sure, does it look like it's actually touching the ground? And we're refining the splining even more. And this is almost finished. We'll just have a look at the tail and then how the tail compares. I think now this is our final animation. We've got all those extra little secondary animation moments with the tail bouncing and the collar. There's like a little bauble under her neck. So, and there's our final shot. Right, so, I don't know if you noticed, but the shot started, I think, on this, if I go back, that was the 9th of June. She started in about the 2nd of May. So it's about 6 weeks of working on that, working on a couple of shots at one time, but nonetheless, it took about 6 weeks to get the animation of that shot final. And one of the big things was, yeah, I think some of the earlier stuff, it looked like it was an older cat. It didn't feel like a kitten. And one of the other tricky things with animation is you might get to this point, animation's approved, then you put the fur on it and render it. Ah, the fur's going through here and it's got the fur's bunching up, so you might go back and do animation fixes. Yeah. So once animation is complete, we can move on into lighting. Our lighting is where it all comes together. Essentially, where you combine the asset with all its surfacing with the animated character and place the CG lights and marry it into the shot. So CGI lighting has improved immensely over the last 20 years. The process is usually software rendered on a CPU. It's a very intensive calculation, sampling the surfaces. You'd think that over the last 20 years, render times would have plummeted, right? As computers have got faster. The accepted render time, so in 2000, the accepted render time was about, for a feature film shot, was about an hour per frame. Now, the render time accepted is about 4 to 10 hours per frame. It's like, what? Doesn't make sense, right? What the hell's going on? Your computers then maybe, a good computer then, like a CGI Octane, might have had half a gig of RAM, now you might have 64 gig of RAM, 600 megahertz MIPS processor, now it's 32 megahertz with 8 cores. Right, what's going on? So your film has 100 minutes maybe, and you might have, if it's a fully CGI film, whatever, 24 frames a second, that's 144,000 frames, 576,000 hours, it's 24,000 days of render time. Now, what's going on? Okay, here's an example here, right? So the cave troll from 2000, here's updated troll from The Hobbit in 2012. I don't know if you can see on this, but basically the surface qualities of the skin, there is so much more going on. They're basically doing physically accurate lighting, and that's the key thing going on. There's looking at the simulations of the substrata of the skin, all the hair and the scattering of light as it goes through there, it looks much, much better. So lighting has shifted to become physically based. The idea is that if we know the calculations of what light is doing, we should be able to simulate that in the CGI software, right? So the lighting you have in your CGI should behave exactly the same as light in the real world. Here's a good example, right? That's Woody from 1995. Here he is in 2010. Huge difference. With accurate algorithms, the artist can now naturally simulate the natural interactions of light in a physically accurate and energy-conserving manner, right? Now, so basically the nice thing about lighting these days is you can light just like you're lighting a real shot. If you wanted to actually create a little light, a little bounce light under someone's face, you can literally put a card in the software off camera, or it can be on camera if you want, and just create it just like you would. It actually makes it much easier to do it than it used to be. So when I started out lighting, this was the model you had. Your light was broken down into your diffuse, the specular was the shiny bit, and the ambient was the sort of fill light. But that's not true. Specular is a reflection. Ambient light is actually the scattered bounce light. I mean, look at the light. The light that we have in this room is all scattered. There's very little direct key light going on in here. So the ball on the right is just full diffuse. The one in the middle is full specular is full reflection. And one of the other one is refraction. So this is all come about because of ray tracing. Skipping ahead too early there. Ray tracing has been around a long time. It was certainly when I started playing with the software in 96, there was ray tracing around, but it was so insanely slow. To render that would have taken probably a day just to render one little shiny ball. But now that's the thing, is you've got all this extra render power on the computers, so they just crank it right up now. And that's why the render times have gone to 4 to 10 hours a frame, because you can. And the price of the computers, that's the other thing, right? The price of the computers have come down, so you can have a render farm with 40,000 cores. So global illumination is one of the big changes that's come along as well. This image really shows clearly, like when I started out, the lighting on the left, this is what you'd have. You'd have, the light would come in through the window, and that's all it would do. It wouldn't do anything else. Now the light would actually comes in, bounces around, picks up the color from the red wall, bounces off, picks up the green, and it actually behaves in an energy-conserving manner. If, in order to create that, you would have had to kind of fake it with a whole lot of other lights, and it was a nightmare. That's why Woody, one of the key reasons why Woody, when you think of that Toy Story, he looks fake. There's all this around the eyes and all those things, there's light where it shouldn't be. And the third key change to the process of lighting is the addition of image-based lighting.
I'm
so a shot like
hedgehog.
This,
head down the wrong wall.
How do we go about lighting a shot like this? Well, what was actually there? We've got grass and we've got sky. It was shot just before dawn. The sun was just coming, just behind the trees, almost coming up. So let's take a photo. So this photo here is a 360, which we saw with the previous talk. This is taken, there's an 8mm lens, fisheye, and it takes six photos and stitches together to create a really high resolution 360 panorama. But this image doesn't have everything. What's missing? Well, the exposure range. So back in about 1850, a photographer, Gustave Le Gray, took multiple exposures with his traditional film in order to kind of compensate for the lack of exposure latitude. And he would combine multiple exposures together. Well, now we can do the same thing. Each of these photos is two stops darker, so 1/4 of the light. And as we keep going, we can see all the extra detail in the sky. Now, if we combine all of those into one image, we can create what's called an HDRI. So your normal image might have, like an 8-bit image has 256 levels. A 32-bit image is now floating point. The idea of black being zero and one being white doesn't mean anything anymore. When you combine these, the sky can be level 20. It can be really bright, which means now when you take that stitch and put it onto a sphere around you, that intensity of the sky can now light your CGI. So here's the scene is evolving. You can see how that light is affecting a gray sphere. And so we often light with our character's gray first, so we're not being skewed by what the shaders and textures are doing. And we use the mirror balls just to sort of as a way to check that the lighting setup is correct. This is a shot from the raw plate from one of our shoots. So we have this mirror ball on a stick, and we spin it around, and on the other side, it's 50% gray. This is shot in a flat log color space. So the camera that we have can shoot with an S-log curve, which basically takes the exposure latitude of the new cameras is phenomenal. I think traditional film would maybe have about 7 stop latitude of range. These cameras have about a 16 to 18 stop latitude of what it's, the noise, the floor of black, and the whitest whites, which is beyond what the actual display devices, none of these display devices do it, but the cameras can actually see it. And it records in a log space. And when we take that guy, so here is the log image. You can't read it on here, but the reading of the value of the bright white there is about 0.8. But when we actually unpack that into linear color space, that value that's actually stored in there is about 18. Now we've got this mirror ball here. I can actually crop that, unwrap that to create a 360, and then actually light my CGI with this mirror ball. So rather than having to use that crazy camera rig, we can just take this guy, and the great thing here is it's gone through exactly the same color space as our CGI as the live action backplates. When you're trying to integrate stuff in matching colors, that makes life much, much easier. So there's our lighting, and our last step in the process is our compositing. This is broken down into two steps, so rotopaint. Here's a raw plate here. Notice the markers on the boy's hat. So the markers are there so they can be tracked. One, to create an object track of the boy's head, but secondly, that's the reason they're there, so we can track it. But they'll also get used to track the paint process. So what you'd actually, like, think of a Photoshop clone brush, you basically track the blue marker in, and if a clone brush from a good bit of the hat comes along and follows it and paints it out. And here's the final, where all the markers painted out, and a little CGI gecko added to the shot. Here's a shot where we needed to put a CGI character between the live action and the background. Now, you could shoot it. You could shoot a foreground plate with a green screen, or you could have a. The problem is then you basically end up, when you throw a green screen on something that's so close, you get a huge amount of green bounce all over the place. Then you fight with the compositing to try and get rid of the green. It's like, why bother? It's so much easier to roto it. So here is what's actually going on, is you creating these animated splines. And that takes someone about maybe a day to do that. And that makes life so much easier in terms of being able to get your performance, shoot quickly. I think we were at about 11 o'clock at night. Everyone wanted to go home. Yeah, so we're not doing a green screen. So we'll fix it in post. So compositing, when you're compositing CGI, you actually now get out quite a lot of different passes. So the renderers these days provide a lot of useful other material. So here's a final shot. We'll look at the actual passes that came into this. So the renderer has like the beauty pass, diffuse. There's a key light. You can actually select which lights and just get the renderer to spit out what each of those individual lights look like. You get the GI, the reflection, the refraction, the subsurface scattering. You can load them into the compositor, split them all out, and adjust each one slightly, or matte just a little bit of it. And then you can basically, so you can kind of relight at the compositing stage. When render times are maybe an hour and a half for each one of these frames, it's much, much faster to work this way and just do it in the compositing. And what is a compositor, right? The compositor is, some of the best compositors I've worked with, they're kind of like they're the rock stars of the visual effects in some ways, and they, on the knight in shining armor, because they save the shot. They're able to pull it all together at the end. But the main thing is that they have a vision of what, here's this crappy plate that I've got, and here's a really badly lit CGI. I think I can make it look amazing. And that's what a really good compositor can do. So here in this shot, when we went up in the airplane, like the rope, for example, didn't actually move. And we actually, when we put the gate on, the lighthouse was being lost in the frame. So the compositor painted out the rope, warped it, put it back in, moved the lighthouse in, so we got it in the shot, and then also added the octopus and got the shadows all working. This is one of the most complex comp shots we've had done. You've got all the CGI of this guy sitting him in behind the glass, but this is a shot in a dentist's office with a very expensive x-ray machine that we did not want to break. So we just very slowly moved it and then had tracking markers on it. And the compositor sped it up and made it look like it would have been a hit, added all the sparks, the smoke, added all the lighting effects through here. Yeah, that was a very complex shot to pull off. And so now we've finished the VFX shot. The shot's now complete and it's ready to go off to be graded into the rest of the pipeline. So some of the biggest lessons that I've had over my experience through the years, especially stuff, I learned a lot when I worked on Lord of the Rings. One of the big things was, how long does it take to do a shot? And it was more like, how long does it take? Oh my God, I couldn't believe it. So I was amazed that after making all my own stuff, and you'd spend maybe a few days or maybe 3 or 4 days on a shot, that's been 3 to 4 weeks on a shot. And then if it was a really hard shot, 3 to 4 months on a shot. I was like, oh, no wonder it looks so good. They spend ages on it. Right, so that's the thing. It's like, it takes a lot of time and an eye for detail. One of the things as a VFX artist, you're making a film, and you have to have an understanding of story. And I didn't really understand this until someone pointed out to me what I was doing right. I had a kind of fairly good instinctual knowledge for story, but I didn't know why my lighting and some of the shots was working. So have a look at these shots. And so the key thing that's going on here is lighting the face. Think about where your eye goes when you look at the shot. And because as a lighting artist, you're not just trying to make it look like it was there. You're also trying to help tell the story. And a key moment is getting the light into the monster's eyes and then glints off the teeth so that it feels like it's dangerous, feels like Frodo's in danger. Because why is the film in the shot? It's there to... That's what you've got to understand what you're doing in that context. You might be stuck tunnel vision thinking, oh, I've just got to make it look real. But you've got to think about what is the shot doing in its in the greater context. And this is sort of more about an industry-wide thing. Some of this, the visual effects industry is undergoing a lot of change. The big companies in LA, Digital Domain, Rhythm and Hues, they're all gone. I mean, LA is a bit of a ghost town now in terms of visual effects. Most of the work, the big centres for visual effects are now Vancouver and London and Wellington, New Zealand. Basically, the studios are following the tax breaks where it's cheaper. Soon, India and China will take over. They'll be even cheaper. A place like Weta, which has maybe fluctuates between 1,200 to 1,800 people, to keep those people on board, you need a lot of work coming in all the time. And how do you get people to come bring their work all the way to New Zealand? You have to be really good all the time. You have to stay at the best. So the people they have there, they've always got to be pushing the envelope of what is possible. And so that's kind of comes down to, and you guys are in a situation where if you ever have a look at the jobs that are on a place like a visual effects studio, the technical side is always under demand. There's a lot of people who want to make beautiful models, a lot of people who want to do animation, a lot of people who want to make pretty pictures. But there's always a lack of people who can do some of the technical work, more complicated stuff, that allows those studios to be the very, very best. Yeah, so keep up. I mean, I wish I had focused more on some of that stuff. So if you're interested, if you want to dig any further into this, there's a lot of material online. There's a really, really good series called Pixar in a Box, which you can find on Khan Academy. It's some of the best introductory material that's out there. It's especially focused at sort of more scientific math programming people. It's all free, and yeah, some of the other sites that are worth considering, FXPhD and Pluralsight, used to be Digital Tutors. Those are the kind of the key things out there. Cool. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoy it. Hope it was useful.
So now we're going to have a quick Q&A. So who wants to ask anything to James?
I wanted to ask if cinematography rules also go into place. Like in the shot from the little squirrel in the end when he gets hit with the log.
Yep.
If the frame rate is bigger than 24 frames per second, and if you apply more frame rates when you want to tell a story about something is about to happen.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, the final delivery format is usually going to be 24. So if you shoot it higher, you're going to be slowing it down to get it to 24. In my case, I don't tend to shoot off speed that much. Mm-hmm. It tends to jar a little bit. You can kind of immediately feel it. Something is different. And it works really well for that montage moment. I mean, my favorite is a Wes Anderson film. I can't remember the title, it's alluding me, where the guy comes out of the lift and he's carrying a box of bees. It's all gone to slow motion, and it's beautiful. But there's, it's something where it can work for certain moments if it's got the right feel, but not for most of my stuff. I've tended to shy away from it. Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello. I used to do 3D modeling. I was wondering what kind of programs do you use? I used to use, if I'm correct, ZBrush and Mudbox.
Yeah, ZBrush is the main tool for kind of conceptual sculpting and final detail sculpting.
Yeah, and the skeleton, if I'm correct. Do you use Mudbox, the skeleton of the animation,
Mudbox,
to do the animation?
Mudbox, not so much.
Yeah.
More ZBrush, but Maya is our main, our sort of, the workhorse software for modeling is Maya.
Okay, thank you.
It depends on the artist.
Yeah, I see.
Yeah, it really does depend. I mean, ZBrush used to be...
It's a question of preference.
Yeah, it is.
Okay.
And Modo is another good tool that's out there now. Mm-hmm. It's made by the Foundry. Yeah, there's a lot of things out there. It doesn't matter as much anymore. It used to matter because the data wasn't so easy to swap around.
Yeah,
but now
we're in a lot of programs available also.
Now there's easy data exchange format, so it doesn't matter.
I see. Thank you very much.
That's cool.
Hello. You talked about how you render the frames on the CPU. Why don't you use the power of the GPU? Is that doesn't it work on the GPU, or is it worse than the CPU?
Not with the level of detail that we need at the moment. It's getting there. There are a few things, like there's a renderer called Redshift that does use some GPU acceleration, but it's not so good with displacements and motion blur. There'll be things that don't quite work. Whereas the software CPU rendering, you've got a lot more control. You'll get all your subsurface scattering. You'll get all the extra little bells and whistles you need to make it look really good. Yeah. So the GPU, though, I would say in 3 or 4 years, it'll be quite. The software renderers will be falling away. Yeah.
So in 3 or 4 years, the rendering time will improve by a lot.
Oh, it'll probably no. The render time is basically comes down to it kind of comes down to how long are people willing to wait, right? If it can look better by waiting half an hour more, they'll wait half an hour. That's always going to be the issue. It's more important of how it looks than how fast it comes out. Games is obviously the opposite. You've got to have it real time, but film, it doesn't matter. You leave it overnight. It doesn't matter.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
Hi, I was wondering about if you had seen specifically in Rogue One in Star Wars, where they did the character animation for Tarkin and Princess Leia, where they they didn't de-age the actors, they did them completely from scratch in CG, and I was wondering if you think that's the way a lot of these productions are going, where they need either people who are dead or people, they need to de-age people, they also did in Civil War, and if you think that's becoming more and more viable, more and more realistic over the next few years, and if you think that'll be popular.
Yeah, I think those two examples from Rogue One are not very good examples. Yeah. To me, they look really fake.
Yeah.
I haven't, the Fast and Furious with Paul Walker, there's a few shots in that that look amazing.
Yeah.
And that's a really good example use of the software, of the technology to achieve a result. It's much easier to film an actor.
Right.
Much easier. Make up in here in a costume, film it. It's the cost. There may be situations where you want to recreate a person of a certain age. But even then, there's a lot of, what was the film? The Curious Case of Benjamin Button.
Right.
Not only did they do the re-aging of
Brad Pitt.
Brad Pitt, but it's the bits where they had them, where they filmed them now and made them look 20 years younger. Right. They kind of erased all the wrinkles, shrunk the nose, took up the jowls, all this. They did all that in compositing. Yeah. That's that sort of thing that is really, I was blown away when I saw those breakdowns.
Right,
I was like,
right.
Wow, that was really impressive. But yeah, I think that it's still, it will become more seen, absolutely. Mm-hmm. But I think there'll be some really good examples and some very poor taste examples.
Yep. I'd say the best case I've seen so far was where they use hybrids, so where they film live action and then improve that instead of doing it from scratch.
Yeah.
Like Fast and Furious, like Civil War with Robert Downey Jr., mm-hmm. that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Anyone else? So we're going to have a quick break and we'll have Michelle next from the Disney.
Thank you, everyone.